Saga of the soul, when you were discussing about the journey of a human soul towards this goal, that story, how it developed. So that ultimately came to an excellent position where we could say, Naham Manushyo. Nacha Deva Yakshaha, Na Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya Shudraha, Na Brahmachari, Na Grihi Vanasthava, Bhikshu nacha aham, nija bodha sarupa, nija bodha sarupa. The ultimate goal of the human soul is to reach to this condition. What is my real identity? Nija means my own, bodha sarupa, sarupa, the identity, and that, about that, my experience, my realization. Adi Shankaracharya, the great philosopher, he has analyzed the phenomenology Jada Jagatik Tattva. This Jagatik, the external, the world that we see, what is it actually? We know how a tree germinating and then slowly becoming a tree. But where from the seed came? Then the science is explaining in different way, the carriers are there, the air, or the birds, the insects, they are carrying, where from they came. So it goes on, questioning, then ultimately goes to epistemology, that's called Jnana-tattva. This knowledge concluded that this creation is not a real creation, but an appearance which God conjures up with his inscrutable power, that is called Maya. Now some people are explaining that God has created this world, and we like to believe that too, because when we are pinching over here, we feel the pain. When we are hungry, we feel that hunger. When we are thirsty, we feel that. We smell, we see, we touch, everything is so very real. Then why not we understand or think or accept that this is real? I went to see one park. There, when they will take you in a boat, an environment, if you go, and they will take you to that African lifestyle. The African people, they are there by the side of the river, they are throwing the arrows, or they are shouting, they are jumping, they are attacking or welcoming. Then suddenly you come face to face with a wild animal, it's drinking water and then also spraying that water all over. It's so very real. Because the grown-up people, they know that something has been made, these are all dolls, but little, the children, they're all shouting, screaming, they are accepting it, it's so very real. But it is not. But we can touch it, we can feel it, we can sense it, we can smell it. They are burning the animals, and all the smell is also coming, it's so very natural, and almost we are bound to think this is natural, this is real, but it is not. somebody made it. It's all illusion. Similarly, all these things that we see, all these things that we feel, our life including, is nothing but, it is appearance. That is what Shankaracharya said. And that's why this is called Veda Anta, the end part of the knowledge. Now we cannot understand it. It's not possible for us to understand. But this is the reality. The moment you realize this, what happens? You are totally detached from this. Nothing can touch you. Or otherwise, sometimes we are happy, sometimes we are unhappy. It goes on and on and on. Because our mind is attached. Now everyone has experiences the illusion, and that, as the Vedanta always say, that there is a rope and we see, because the environment, the situation was so that we think that this is nothing but a snake. It's a twilight, we cannot see it properly. And the condition of the rope and the way it was there lying, it was there left, as if it is real, so that rope became a snake to us. We can see it, we can feel it, but it is not real. So Shankaracharya, again and again, giving so many different type of illustrations, examples, and say, this world is not that way real. So, but he is also, he knew that it is not possible for us, for anyone, to understand it immediately. So he has given two things, one after another. One is Vyavaharika, another is Paramarthika. This Paramarthika is transcendental. Vyavaharika, day-to-day life as we are behaving now. Each and every one is searching for peace, happiness, joy. How we can get that? There are so many other things out there. Go and do this, go and do that. Some people, they find joy in a very good job like serving others. But again, when you go to serve others, then there will be criticism, there will be other things will come. That may happen again. There's a great personality was there, Vidyasagar Mahashaya. At the time of Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna, Sri Ramakrishna went to meet him. So, if that person also, at the end of his life, he suffered. Why? Because he was thinking that everybody will be happy. But no, it was not. So that way, one is Vyavaharika, another is Paramarthika. The secret is, and that is what Swami Vivekananda called as the Karma Yoga. And Sri Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita said, you cannot simply stop, sit and think that I am not doing any work. Your mind is working. Intense work is going on inside your mind. You are sitting over here doing nothing, but when you see, oh, these people are not doing it properly, reaction is coming. Oh, that, why he is going in this way, why he is talking in this way, reaction is coming. So you are also working. You are attached in that. So this secret is, observe and do not be affected by it. And that is the condition of the mental condition of the rishis. And that they call Shanta Bhava. Shanta means quiet, peaceful. They are observing but not reacting. Why? Because they know this is temporary. When they saw that some people are making the castles on the seashore and they are so, don't come over here, don't step over there, because the castles they are making, from distance you see and oh, temporary. After some time, nothing will remain. So the same psychology when we are applying with everything, you are in that society, but without any attachment in that. So the boat is on the water, but water is not inside the boat. So that is called paramarthika bhava, transcendental condition. If we can constantly keep in our mind, so the vyavaharika, this present day life, day to day, all these practices. Now naturally you have to explain, what about our God? Is he affected by this or not? He is simply an appearance that we are imagining, or he is real? Then he said, the God is becoming saguna brahma, nirguna brahma. Saguna is having the qualities, and now we can cook and offer to God. We can feel that God is taking that food and he's so happy, he's blessing me. Saguna, he's having all the qualities, satta, raja, tama. And sometimes God is angry with me. Sometimes God is not doing anything. He has already left. So that condition, all these three gunas, satta, raja and tama, all these three gunas are there in my God also. That's saguna brahma. And slowly, slowly it is proceeding. So nirguna brahma, saguna brahma. Nirguna means nothing is there. Just like when the fire is burning, there is a sound of the wood burning, and then the sparks are coming out and you can see the fire, but when all that has gone, only that fire remains in that wood, that is the light, there is a brightness, there is a power, but no action at all. That is called nirguna brahma, as if. So we are also having this thing, but why this problem? Why we cannot see the transcendental condition? There's a name, they say transcendental meditation. You have to transcend. And today I was teaching two, three people meditation. Then I told, as usual, all gurus they do, that you have to worship your deity, God, coming out of your body. Your deity is sitting within your heart, and your deity is facing the side you are facing. So naturally, you have to come out of your body, and then you have to see the deity sitting within your heart, transcendental. You have to trance, you have to go over the body consciousness. I am these, I am these. This body consciousness, when its little baby is coming, we constantly go on asking, hey, what is your name? Which your papa? What is your papa? All this. Go on asking. Slowly, slowly, slowly that baby start thinking, this is me. This body is me. Then when you become very old, God forbid, we forget that this is me. We forget that this is my family, my children, my wife, my son, my daughter, my this and that. Nothing. There's a very dangerous type of disease is there. That time people, they forget. I met a lady, old lady. She was having that disease. Her son is taking so much of care. And when the son went to her room and told, Ma, the Swamiji has come. Moment she saw me, she remembered Geruva, she offered pranam and then asked the son, hey, who are you? Entered into my room, go out. He told, I have brought this Swami and I am your son, I am serving daily, regularly, and you can't recognize me. She can't, but she recognizes, I was showing the Sri Ramakrishna, that picture was there, Sri Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, everything. And then suddenly she told, hey, to ask, pointing to her son, offer pranam to this, sannyasi, sannyasi, pranam karo, offer pranam to him. And then after some time, go out from my room, who are you? So we begin with slowly, slowly identifying this body, and then a time comes we forget our body, but not that condition. Forgetting the body, going beyond the body, the transcendental condition is a different condition. It goes upward. And that is the joy. I am not this body. And that's why in the Bhagavad Gita it says in a wonderful way, it says, like a old used garment, we give up this body. And then we, as the body also, just we are treating as an old used garment. And we go to another body, as a new body. So why you are crying? Why you are afraid? What is death? Only changing the body. So that is a different thing. So Vyavaharika, the external, and Paramarthika. We have to hold on to Paramarthika, and then we have to go on doing in whatever the duties, responsibilities, Vyavaharika in this life. And that way, slowly we can go move towards the ultimate goal. But what is the problem? Avidya, they say. What is that avidya? Is a wrong knowledge. We accept this as permanent, though we know everything is changing, every moment it is changing. We do not know what is going to happen next moment. Everything is changing. But we accept this very moment as true. And then afterwards, either we enjoy or suffer, this is called avidya. So slowly we have to go and go how? Vedanta Tattva, the theory of Vedanta. And what is the Vedanta Darshan? They call Prasthanatraya. As I was telling the last day, the three great exit or the path. And they are Upanishads, Brahma Sutra, and Bhagavad Gita. That is the traditional, that is a Hindu concept. Three great exit is there. One is Upanishad, and then Brahma Sutra, and then Bhagavad Gita. Now the Upanishads are the end part of the Veda. Upa means near. And the truth is, you are God. Suppose you tell it to some person, then what he will think? He will misunderstand it. And he will say, I am God. I have no problem. And he can behave very erratically. I can do this, I can do that, I am God, I am God. I was seeing an advertisement about some movie, The God, like that. And he was going on doing all peculiar things. So something happened and he started thinking himself God, and he was behaving very, very peculiarly. Why? Because the training was not there. So you have to get the training properly. What is that training? Understanding that knowledge. What is that knowledge? Upanishad. And what Upanishad says? And the very first sloka of the Upanishad, Isha Upanishad, Ishavasyam idam sarvam, yat kincha yagatyam jagat, tena taktena bhunjita, ma gridhak kasyasi dhanam. These two lines, a wonderful sloka, and it gives the whole gamut of Hinduism. This whole thing, everything is nothing but covered with the God, the Supreme. Naturally, understanding that, you live your life. Why you are hankering for those things which are totally temporary? So this way, we are moving. Sometimes some people, young people, they come for counseling, they are students. So they are not understanding what to do, what not to do. Then I told, always tell them, focused on what you are doing now. What is your goal? To become a doctor, to engineer, or this or that. How many years are left? 1.5 years. Complete that. Achieve one goal. Concentrate on that. Don't think about anything else. what happens? He or she, going towards a particular goal and achieving that, that is one thing. And at the back of it, which is not that particular person understanding, developing concentration, withdrawing mind from everything, is putting that mind to that goal, becoming successful, so automatically mind is getting trained to be concentrated. Now, that concentrated mind, that trained mind, you turn towards God. Now you have achieved this, now you are earning money, now you are having everything, are you happy? Not completely. So turn your mind towards God, more higher, more higher, more higher. So this way we go, go and go. Ultimately we have to reach to that Brahman, and they say Tattvamasi. They are telling Tattvamasi to whom? Who has already completed all this. And suddenly if we say Tattvamasi to a baby or a grown-up man but not having the spiritual idea, you are Brahman, you are God, then what will happen? That's why in Christianity, as because the people at that time, 2000 years before, you have to understand, and mainly in the Middle East, there the Christianity grew, and they were telling, no, though Jesus said, blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they shall see God, but the theology afterwards developed, you are a sinner, come and pray every Sunday, and go and give this donation, and then go and serve. And this type of volunteering in great in Christianity, come and do some services. Why they have introduced all this? Because of the people. Now for the children, they always say, you have to come in time to the school. You have to bring these notebooks, these books. You have to do this, you have to do that. Everything, they go on. Then slowly, slowly, when they reach to that level of university, only the routine is there, you just follow. Nobody is there to look after you, because you are already trained. Thus, that way, you have to train yourself in spiritual life, and the training is first going to a guru. You have to go to a guru, and that guru will train you. How he will train? First is physically some hard work you have to do, you must have to practice that. You have to fast, practice fasting, and do, go and do this, do that, different type of work. Slowly, slowly, your ego will break. I am so and so, I am coming from that family, I am this and that. One Swamiji, he afterwards he became very famous Swami of the Ramakrishna Mission. When he joined, he was dressing the vegetable with other brahmacharins. We all did. But don't ask me now, I forgot. So this, all this dressing the vegetable in Indian way, you know, very difficult. It's not with the machine, but in a very slowly they are doing. And then his father came. He was a very rich man's son. And moreover, he was highly educated. His father came there suddenly and saw his son is doing that, dressing the vegetable. My son, you have become a sannyasi to only to dress the vegetable? Come back. I will give you the full load of vegetable. Go on doing that. Then the son said, no, father, it is not the dressing the vegetable. Any work that has been given to me, I am doing with only one of that goal, to achieve the blessings of mother. Mother means the goddess. So this is the blessings of mother, whatever I am doing, sweeping the floor, cleaning, arranging the flower, decorating, cooking, everything with one only goal, to get the blessings of the mother. So that is exactly what we always try to tell our volunteers. Why you are coming over here, volunteering? Nobody forced you to come. Nobody forced you to come. If anybody is forcing you to come, you are not a volunteer. You are a labor, bonded labor, paid labor. But when you are opting, no, I will go, I will do, I will serve volunteering of your own. And then when you are volunteering, then what is the goal of your this work? Just in the society, I do some good work to spend some time, this is a different thing. Or to get the attraction of something or the certificate. Sometimes in our in a society also, the students, they will come and they say, I have to work or do something and 8 hours social service, give us a certificate. 8 hours social service, give us a certificate, because that will be included in there. Marks will be there. Are they volunteer? No. Their goal is to get the marks and particularly the certificate from that institution. No volunteering. Volunteering is that I am going over there to serve God, to get God's blessings. And nowhere I am looking, I am cleaning, God will bless me. If nobody is noticing, doesn't matter at all. I am cooking, I am doing this, I am doing that with that. And that is called knowledge. Jnana. What is that jnana? God is there. And God is observing everything. And when I am doing something good, I am going to get blessings of God for sure. So that is called jnana, conviction. And afterwards, when after doing that, then I find, who is God? Who is coming to bless? What is that blessing? I am already blessed. Aham Brahmasmi. The person is going to a guru, and guru is giving him tattva. Tattva means the knowledge. What is that knowledge? Tattvam asi. You are that. But to reach to that, to understand that, he is going through so many disciplines. But ultimately, one day, suddenly he is understanding, the revelation is coming, nobody is telling him, but from within, Aham Brahmasmi. I have nothing to do in this world. Naham Manushyo. Can you understand when a person is telling like this? Hastamalaka, the disciple of Shankaracharya. Naham Manushyo. I am not human being. Don't call me as a human being. And suppose somebody do not call you as a human being, what will happen? Immediately you will be so angry. You will go to the court. This man is abusing me like this. Naham Manushyo, nacha deva, yaksha. I am not God even. I am not in between God and human being. So that way it goes, and then say, nija bodha sarupa. I know who am I. Whether you praise me or blame me, it doesn't matter at all. I know who am I. That is the ultimate goal of a human soul. How to reach here becomes the divisions, because Upanishads are many, and Upanishads, they gave only the sutras, this, and different way it says, Om iti Brahma. Then naturally afterwards we will be studying the Upanishads also, the bird's eye view, the brief way, all the Upanishads we will try to touch. These Upanishads are giving you an Isha Upanishad, Keno Upanishad, Katha Upanishad. There are so many. Shankaracharya wrote commentaries on 11. Brihadaranyak, Chandragya, all these 11 Upanishads, he gave the commentaries. All books are, that is the very good thing now. The modern society, now they have the translation. He wrote the commentaries. What is the commentary? Explanation. What is the explanation? Otherwise you won't understand. When suddenly the rishi is telling, Isha Vashyam Idam Sarvam. Then the question will come, Idam Sarvam, everything? All the dog and me, everything is covered by the God? What is it? I am equal, how that can be? Then he is explaining how it is. The explanation is necessary because of that. Confusion should not be there. Doubt should not be there. No question should be there. All questions should vanish. Tasmin dishte para avare. chindanti sarva samsayaha. All samsaya, all doubts are cut asunder, vanishes when we realize that. Sri Ramakrishna is giving a wonderful story. When I see God, how I will understand that it is God? Then somebody should be there, and the old guru will also go along with me to introduce, this is God. Where is guru? He is dead and gone. Then how I will get there? Then Sri Ramakrishna told the story. One person came from the village and he heard the king is a great personality. And the first he came and he saw the guard standing over there, like that our queen's guards in England. The people go and take the picture of them. They are nicely dressed, beautifully they are standing over there like the dolls. So they go and that he saw, oh dear God, but why so many guards? Because the guards with beautiful dresses. Then someone told, no, they are guards only, they are not gods, go inside. Then he went, the ministers, bigger ministers, other ministers, like that all the more and more and more and more they go. He was traveling, he saw more beauties. And finally he reached to that throne, before that throne where the king is sitting. Immediately he understood, oh, this is the king. He bowed down. So similarly, when we are going towards, then we saw someone, he is putting the hand like this, immediately something is falling down. Oh, it's a great soul. Is he God? Of course he will say, I am God. But is only the beginning of God. Maybe a little expression, then more and more and more and more. Then ultimately when you realize God, then there is nothing else remain. And you say that, oh, this is what is God. What is that God? When you see that, what is remain? Peace and nothing else. There's no question, no doubt. Chindanti sarva samsayaha. And that is called, then Advaita, they say in this way, you have to realize that soul within yourself, because except that nothing remains. The Shankaracharya, he is the main of Advaita. Dvaita means two, A means negation, negative. No two, only one remains. And ours is that Advaita Darshana, Vedanta Darshana. We follow that Vedanta. But then when we are following the Vedanta, why this worship, why this picture? And now it is more and more pressure coming on us. Maharaj, why not Durga Puja? Why not Kali Puja, one after another? Because the ritualistic portion, people can understand that. But we are going on trying to tell, no, philosophy is necessary. So some people, they go for ritualistic, some people for the philosophy. We are that philosophical. But Swami Vivekananda understood when he was organizing this thing. He understood that the people won't be able to understand the Advaita philosophy. It's not for all. So what he did, he combined. In the Belur Math, if you go, there is the deities there. And everything, all pujas are going on. From today itself, the Shashti, the Durga Shashti is going on, the huge pandal and the Durga image, all monks are there, thousands of people will be sitting. Shashti puja, from the beginning of the Durga puja, the 5 days will continue, this is also there. But at the same time, the same Ramakrishna mission having Advaita Asrama, Advaita again. In the Himalaya, if you go, in the Uttarakhand, not even a picture, nothing is there. And when you go over there, Swamiji, is there any temple? They will say, come. They will take you to a place and show, look at that Himalaya. And your left hand and right hand, 180 degree, all the vastness of Himalaya, that is God. Concentrate on that vastness. And look at the sky. The vastness. You just be quiet, you see it, terribly quiet place. Nothing is there, that quietness, that is God. So then after one or two days, they will say, oh, the cooking is very good, but not about the Brahman. About the Brahman will think afterwards, but your cooks are very excellent cooks. So then they will come out. And you, if you like, you can go there. It's a wonderful place inside the Himalaya. Swami Vivekananda liked it very much. And all the Swamis over there, they are practicing meditation and japa, and it's a very good guest house. Recently it has come up, you can go and stay for 3 nights. So there in the Himalaya, go and meditate and think about the vastness, and that is the path of Advaita Shankaracharya. And obviously, further, there will be again some people in between. That is Advaita, and also something must be there to hold on. So Vishishta Advaita, qualified monism. Ramanuja Charya, Acharya means the teacher. Ramanuja is the name, Acharya is the teacher. The Ramanuja Charya, he is giving this excellent explanation that is called Vishishta Advaita, special Advaita. But it's a special. Then come Dvaitism, totally different. I cannot understand, I cannot think of the I am God. That type of mentality is for Dvaitism. We all begin with Dvaita. Sometimes some people will come and say, can I touch your feet? Though I feel like asking, what is the speciality in me? Why you have to touch my feet? But I'd never say that. Why? Because if you say that, the one little devotion that is growing up, that will also go. And total confusion will be there. They're okay. So that way, slowly, slowly we develop dualism. My God, my Guru, my Master, my Dev. So God is there, I am here. And we are touching like this. So this is called three stages, and this is the uniqueness of Indian tradition. It is giving the rooms for each and everyone. I like to worship my God, see my God in this way, come on, it is there. And you think in a different way, think in a different way, all are accommodated in the Hinduism. And only yesterday evening I came back from the Salt Lake City, the Parliament of Religions. Of course, the name is Parliament of Religions, but the religious people were not there. I was very much, and I was searching, where are the religious people? And I am going to write to them at least, because my feeling is a huge, big auditorium, 10,000 people sitting, and all the people sitting over there, either politician or businessman or this or that, the governor, then governor, all this is necessary. But the whole purpose is for religion, where the religious people, they are in the backside. And they brought them afterwards, and there was not a single seat for them. And they were standing over there, and for the religious people, only 2 minutes, you just give the blessings. To whom to bless? So this is a wrong conception. Why? Because the world is organizers. I am sorry to say, and it is being recorded. But the thing is, it is true. When we are organizing something external, when the king comes, we neglect the sage or saint. But who is great? The king? No. They are temporary, only for a few days. Then he will be no more governor, no more this and that. So this way we have to understand. But the organizers always think, this is a chance that I will come so close to the governor, sitting by the side of the governor, and then whispering something unnecessarily with him to show when the picture is coming that I am whispering something with the governor. Then what for the religion? So that we do not understand. That is the mistake. And we always think this temporary thing important, wrong. That's why this Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya, Ramanujacharya, that way they are same. They say no, Jivan Mukti or the Mukti, the liberation is the ultimate. Whether you see God separately, whether you see God apart, whether you see God within yourself, that is different. But the goal is liberation. All these three paths are going to the same goal. Now the Vedanta, the end of the Vedas, Upanishads are the main. I'll just give a brief of this. Why this name Upanishad came? There are so many, 108 Upanishads they could find out. Now they say there were many others. Shankaracharya chose only 11. Adi Shankaracharya, he is an excellent, though he passed away very young, but within that short period, he collected all this and wrote all these explanations on the 11 Upanishads. And why this Upanishad? Last literature of the Vedic period. That's called Upanishad. It is a part of the Veda, but now it is considered as the Veda. Veda means knowledge. But the Upanishad is a part of the Veda. It's not the complete Veda. And in the Vedic hymns and their mantras are there in the beginning. Look at it. The Veda begins with the hymns, the mantras. The Rig Veda, full of mantras. The hymns are there. And this Samhita is called Samhita. Then Vedic rituals are there. So many varieties of ways. The Homa, Yajna, all these things will. So that's called Brahmanas. Then Vedic knowledge, that is called Upanishad. So that is the end. What is the Upanishad? The Veda. Why Veda? Means the end part of knowledge. What is that knowledge? Again, Upanishad. So Upanishad and Veda, they are the same. Now traditionally, one is supposed to study Samhita, then Brahmana, then Upanishad. In olden days, they study in this way. Today, nowadays also, there are many schools are there, they will teach you Veda. And there, first you have to understand the Samhitas. Samhita means all the stotras. And after that, if you go to the traditional, the Brahmins, they will come, they will go on chanting something. Most of the words, it is so uncommon, but still, they are from the Vedas. Then come the Brahmanas, then the Yajnas will be performed, then comes the Upanishad. Upanishad is called Rahasya Vidya. Rahasya means secret. It's not for all. It's a secrecy. What is that secrecy? What we were talking that. Rahasya means the secrecy is because if you are not ready to understand it, naturally you will make the wrong uses of that knowledge. That's why very secretly they used to tell. That has come down even to the mantra diksha. That the disciple should come very close to the guru, and guru will whisper the God's name to the ear of the disciple. That's called Rahasya Vidya. You are not supposed to write it down. You are not supposed to tell it to somebody. You have to go on repeating and remembering because your mind should be focused on that. That's called Rahasya Vidya. Rahasya means the secrecy. Then that mantra goes in the mind and I am conscious, alert, I should not forget. My pronunciation must be perfect. Then that way one should go on doing. And it goes so near to the Guru. Upa is near. And because of that knowledge, all the bondages are gone. So that is called Upanishad. So this is Upanishad. What gets a person near to the teacher is Upanishad. The teacher is God. And the Upanishads were having different shakhas, many. Then naturally, a system was necessary. As the time goes and it is necessary to systematize the thing. Then somebody, and then like a grandfather, they came and purchased this plot of land. Then his son came, he gave the fencing, a boundary wall, and developed a little. Then his son came, he developed a building, utilized that property. Like this it goes, developing. The science, someone developed something, but that was very crude. Next man came, started from there, that knowledge, then develops. Like this, the Upanishads also, this necessity was there for systematizing. A great personality came, and his name is Veda Vyasa. Vishala Buddhe, about him it says, Vishala Buddhe. Vishala means unfathomable. That intellect, Vishala Buddhe, Veda Vyasa. That's why the Veda Vyasa is considered for the guru of all the Hindus. All the Hindus, sometimes if a Hindu is having the mark straight way, he will never go and mix with the one who is having the other way. Only because of the marking. Early morning he will get up and give a mark. He doesn't know about God or anything, but mark. So when the mark, after the bathing, because of the hot, you know, the summer, so they will go and bathe in the early morning and they will put a marking over here. If it goes straight, is a different card. If it goes horizontal, different card. If it is a red one and round one, different card. But all these Hindus come together and they say, Veda Vyasa is our guru. They said Guru Purnima because of that. Why this Veda Vyasa considered guru? He gave us this thing. He gave all the Vedas in a wonderful way, Rig, Sham, Yaju, Atharva. Then he wrote this wonderful thing that is called Brahma Sutra. Brahma Sutra is the Sharidaka Sutra, also Vedanta Sutra. Brahma Sutra, Sharidaka Sutra and Vedanta Sutra, the same book. Same thing. And Vedanta Darshana is the one part of the Vedanta Darshana is Brahma Sutra. Vyadarayan, that's called Vyadarayan, and to systematize, he gave the Sutra. Sutra means only just a hint about it, because he was not having time. He gave the Sutras, the hint about it. So the Brahma Sutra. Athato Brahma Yajnasa, Brahma, that is, begins with. Only Athato Brahma Yajnasa. Now if you go and read, Shankaracharya is giving a big explanation on Atha, Brahma and Yajnasa, and the four words. So this is the way it was going on. That's called Bhashya. In Sanskrit, it's called the Bhashyas. Now, every Tuesday, we are studying over here Panchama Veda. But the actual name of the book that we are following is the Kathamrita, the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. I gave the name, coined the name Panchama Veda. Why? I felt it's just like the Veda giving the knowledge. Now, when we are studying something, Sri Ramakrishna is telling this way, that way, immediately I am quoting from different verses, quoting from different scriptures, giving the example and explaining only one line in so many, almost 1 hour on that one line. That is called Bhashya, explaining. And it gives, naturally people can understand. Mainly they are telling, now we can understand this, because they don't have time to ponder over there, thinking on that. So that way, this Shankaracharya, Ramanuja, Madhva, they all came and they wrote in their understanding as the Bhashyas. Each tried to justify its position, and the authors of these commentaries, Bhashya, became the founder of particular schools of Vedanta. They are all Vedantin. So Vedanta is the total, but they are having the three. One is Advaita, Vishishta Advaita and the Daita. Now each school is having large number of followers. Each school is having that way. And then only one question, will you believe? Only one question on which they differed and they analyzed is, what is the nature of the relation between the self, the jiva, and the God Brahman? What is the nature of relation? That's all. Who am I? Who is my creator? And what is our relation? These are the three questions, but it combined, they said, what is the nature of the relation between the self, the jiva, and God, Brahman? The beauty of Hinduism is this, that here everything is explained very nicely. And you have to explain it. If you cannot explain, then nobody is going to accept it. That is the main purpose, you have to explain. And here they are going on asking question. Now Shankaracharya, the great exponent of Advaita Vedanta, he said two are absolutely identical. Tattvamasi aham brahmasmi. So that is all same, that's all Brahman. Two are completely identical, there is no difference. And Ramanuja explained, two are related, like part and the whole, and this became qualified monism. One is monism that became Advaita, and another is qualified monism, Vishishta Advaita. What is the difference? They said only one, and there is no two. Then how come all this that we see is all wrong that you see? You see in a mirage so many things. Is it true? No. It is your projection. You all projected your idea on that simple dry, the sand, land of sand, and you were thinking that it is a wonderful place. No. So the world that you see, it is your projection, Shankara is saying. It is all one and not two. And then Ramanuja explained, no, it is a part and the whole. There is a fire, and from that fire is also sparks are coming out. They are also the part and parcel of that fire. It is also having all potentialities and the qualities of the fire. But it is different from fire. But Madhva narrated, self and God are two totally different entities. This view is known as dualism. In Veda we find the hymns in the beginning and then the praises of the different deities like the Agni, Mitra, Varuna, Indra, and so many stories are there on this Indra. And we consider that Indra is the king of all gods. He is good at the same time, like a king, always making some problem for others. So this way the Indra and the sacrifices, lot of sacrifices they are doing, they are giving everything, the first thing must be given to the God. And there are many deities also who are governing different natural phenomena like the fire, the sun, the wind, the rain. Why? We are constantly worshipping these gods. Why? Because we need the life, we need the agriculture, we need the prosperity. Now you remember the story of Sri Krishna. His father, foster father, he was organizing a puja, great worship for Indra. Why? Because otherwise Indra will be angry and he will stop giving the rain, the water. Then what will happen to our life? So you all die without that water. Sri Krishna, as a young boy, he said, stop that, you need not to do that. I will protect you, have faith on me. And then when really the Indra attacked, because he was not getting that worship, and he attacked, then the Krishna lifted Govardhana hill. And that Govardhana hill showed even a human being can become God. All these years, all this time, God means on the somewhere in the atmosphere, somewhere in the heaven, we do not know. Now the Krishna told, no, human being can also become God. It is a quality. So this is slowly the history is developing, spiritual history. That I am trying to tell you. First is polytheism, P-O-L-Y, theism, T-H-E-S-I-M. Polytheism means belief in many gods. That's polytheism. Then comes henotheism. The henotheism believe in one supreme god. There are many gods are there, but there must be a master, someone in charge. Otherwise, then our Ramakrishna Mission is having nearly 185 centers all over the world. And each and every center is having a monk, a few monks. Now all these centers, individual, now I am here looking after this center, I am taking decision, but over someone is there, he is actually taking care of me, whether I am doing good or not, something wrong, and what are the purpose of this center, whether I am carrying that or not. And like that, all the Swamis, 80 Swamis, who are in charges, 185, there is one person that is called General Secretary. And in all organizations, Secretary General, General Secretary, CEO, different type of names they give, but there is someone. That is called henotheism. The when our General Secretary recently visited, you know, and then someone, some of our monk, he was telling, is a henotheism can be applied, you know, yeah, because he is the supreme person taking care of all the centers, and we are different in different places. So polytheism, henotheism, H-E-A-N-O, and theism. And then slowly it developed monotheism. See how when the human concept is developing, intellect is developing, understanding is developing, the God's conception is also developing. The first is polytheism, then henotheism, monotheism, the only one God. In Rig Veda we find ekam sad vipra bahudha vadanti. Now there are American kirtan parties are there. The American kirtan parties, they take up one sloka and over that nicely they sing, not like the Indian kirtan parties. Kirtan means the singing and praising God, that's called kirtan. It's not only songs, praising God. So this Indian kirtan, they will be having the full song and explaining. Americans, very nicely, they have utilized only one line and then repeating that in different tunes rhythmically. So that is called ekam sad vipra bahudha vadanti. Why I remembered this? Because I remembered one group of the American kirtan team came and they sang ekam sad vipra bahudha vadanti in our Chicago calling program, that 150th in 2013. So that is ekam sat, one is true, vipra, the people, bahudha vadanti, they give many names like Agni means fire, Yama, the god of death, Matarishwa means this air. So different names are given, but God is one. The development in thoughts is very clear. From polytheism through henotheism, ultimately to monotheism. Slowly the thought proceeded and the monotheism, God is one, but he has various manifestation in many gods. That development came. The many gods are there, but they are the manifestation of the one God. And this is here where the Indian philosophy is differing from Western philosophy. In Western philosophy, they say panentheism. P-A-N, pan means all. E-N-N means in. Theos, theos means God. So that means panentheism, all are not God, but in God. But you have to go to God, but you are not, all are not God. But we say pantheism, only pan, Only 2, en, is less, but the whole meaning is different. Pantheism, all are manifestation of the same God. So, how this world was created? Now the conclusion comes. Only one God was there, consciousness was there, and that all pervading, the moment we say all pervading everywhere, it cannot have any form, any figure. The moment there is a figure, whether round or triangular or whatever, the moment we talk about the figure, so naturally it is only in one place. So it is everywhere. The God is having place everywhere, that Indian concepted monotheism. By this way, the distinction it from the Christians and Islam. And belief in the unity of all gods, now we conclude by telling this, is a wonderful shukta. Shukta means as a poem, short of poem. There it is explaining, very modern, even then a thousand years have already passed. There is also modern in comparing with 6,000, 7,000 years. It says there is a Purusha. Purusha means the conception of one human being. And it goes on like this, Om Sahasrashi Rasha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapat Sabhumim Vishvato Britva Atyatishtad Dashangulam. It goes on like this. Unique way of explaining the whole concept of the Vedanta. Shahastra Shirasha Purushaha. And now some people, some ladies particularly, the moment you say Purusha, why not the ladies? It is that Purusha means not the male bodies. Purusha means some consciousness which is within the heart of each and everyone. Pura, pura means a place, the pura sabha, etc., etc., that we call. Pura means a place, the residing place where that consciousness is. That means the heart of every being. The sahasra shirasa, that person is having 1,000 heads. Shall we count the 1,000? No. The Ganesha is having an elephant head. And when you look at the other gods and goddesses, so many heads. Why? To give this conception, many, everywhere, very big, 1,000 eyes and 1,000 feet. If you draw a picture or make an image of it, is a very peculiar god. But then the next line it goes, Sahasra Shirasha Purushaha Sahasraksha. Aksha means the eye. Sahasrapad, that means the feet. Sabhumim Vishyato Vritva, is all side, is covering. He covered all sides, but still it is 10 fingers length beyond it. It is giving an, as a measurement, 10 fingers beyond it, that means beyond this. So this is called Attatishta Dashangulam, Dasha Angula. Angula means the fingers, as if the 10 fingers beyond this, that beyond all this. He created everything and went beyond this, still beyond this. And same, the person having this way is called the Purusha Sukta. It pervades the whole world, but remain beyond it. Friends, today, from today actually, the Durga Puja is going on. And if you go to the goddess Durga, I'll be, after this I will go to, because they have invited me, the Bengali Association. So for me it is free, but for you I think you have to pay to enter there. So, because they hire a hall and they will give you food and all that. And naturally they charge something. But our Durga Puja, here we will observe in an Advaitic way. So naturally, if you can come on 20th, that means in Tuesday evening, and that means in India it is morning, that is exactly that time the Durga Ashtami is very difficult to maintain in America, but this Durga Ashtami we are going to observe. There will be a puja, no charges. You are all welcome. There will be very good prasad and pushpanjali, and of course some of the boxes written donation will be there here and there. To remind you that we need some help too. So this is Durga. If you go and see 10 hands, there's also the same way. And when that Durga was created, I have written an article over that. I will try to print out some and keep it for you. We should go and understand that decoding, that is nowadays they are using the word decoding. Why Durga is like that? How Durga was created? Asura was creating problem, so the gods went to the Supreme God. All gods, now just now all this philosophy that we have discussed today, now you see the story, all gods went to the Supreme God. So polytheism, then henotheism, then coming and monotheism. All gods went to the Supreme God and they were sitting over there, and that they went and told, sir, this person is so much creating problem for us. So how could he get so much of power? Because you gave the blessings. Your blessings, because of that only he is so powerful. So the all power is coming from God. But that sometimes some people misutilizing that power, they are becoming asura. And the shura means who are properly utilizing God's power. That they went and then they became very angry. When they became angry, that the story goes, and then slowly, slowly all that power started coming out from the body of that Supreme God, then from all gods and goddesses, it combined, a beautiful figure, a mother figure came up. Uma Himavati, that's a wonderful figure, came. Then all gods gave their power too. The Himalaya gave the lion the power over that, she will see it to fight. So that's the story. Then first day this, second day, third day, like this it went on. One lady rang me and told, Swamiji, today I have read that Panchami, yesterday the Panchami. So I have read the Chandi. Chandi is the main book. I have read up to the Panchamadhyaya. And good. So Shastra Adhyaya will continue. So that way it goes on. It is a wonderful way the explanation is coming. The more you read like that, but ultimately what, you know, I don't know this, mainly nowadays they are preparing the goddess Durga. This image that we are going to see is a plastic image or some fiberglass image. But when they are making the image with the art, the mud, that is coming from a very low caste person, that from there first mud will come, and second it will come from a king, third will come from a brahmana. That means it's not the brahmana or the kshatriya or the shudra, it is sapta raja tama. This is they are collecting and making. The water there now you have to put for Durga Puja, it should be collected minimum 7 rivers. You have to collect the water from 7 rivers. And in Belur Mot they collect the water from Jordan also. So that river water is also they are utilizing. And then Shapta Samudra, that means the ocean, they will collect the oceans, that water they will also collect. And in the, why this? Because God is all pervading. And that God is all powerful. But that God is mother. That is very important. Though she is sitting on the lion, though she is killing the demon, though she is having 10 hands, that is showing all over, she is. But ultimately, God is our beloved mother. And if you go and say, mother, I am sorry for all the mistakes that I have done. Now I am tired. Please take me on your lap and give me peace, happiness, progress, success, everything you will get. Everything. Only thing you have to believe, God is there and God is my so close like my mother. And if I go and pray to my mother, the Divine Mother, she will give me anything that I pray. Sometimes people are asking for the success, sometimes beauty, sometimes knowledge, sometimes wealth. Everything will come if the Goddess Durga is blessing you. So today, that is also giving the same theory, same that proof is there. Now the basic differences and the common things of the Advaita, Vishishta Advaita and Dvaita, we will discuss in the next Sunday. But I think the next Sunday will be the our retreat. The next Sunday we will have a retreat in the Ganges. So Bharadanandaji will deliver on my behalf here. But that after the retreat, when you meet again, we will discuss that in a very interesting way. I brought the book to read out from the Advaita and Vishishta Advaita. Now there is no time, and no time for questioning also. You have any question about this? Not much time left. No? Okay then. Now let us chant this mantra again. So let me remind you, it is a constant development, and the development of mental, spiritual, the growth that is going on, developing all the external things, and similarly science is developing our life in so nice way, spirituality also developing our inside, the mental mind and spirit in a wonderful way. Ultimate we have already reached, that is called Advaita Vedanta, where all fingers are coming towards me. It is me, me and me alone, and there is nothing else. So that we again and again reminding ourselves. Naham manushyo, na cha deva yakshah, na brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya shudrah, na brahmachari, na grihi banasthava, bhikshur na cha aham, nija bodha sarupa, nija bodha sarupa. Om shanti shanti shanti, Hari Om Tat Sat.